Imagine an Excel spreadsheet containing loads of data on things like population numbers, taxes, and even major conquests. Except what you're looking at is a bunch of knots and string. And it's the year 1532. That's basically what happened when Spanish colonizers encountered the Inca Empire along the western South American coast, a massive territory they'd been growing for almost a century. The Inca had pretty much everything you'd expect in an empire, like big cities and a developed road system. But they were missing one thing virtually every other world empire has had: writing. Although they did have all those knotted cords called khipu, and it seems like these bundles of strings helped the Inca keep records and run that massive empire, somehow. So what are all these knots about? How can they be used to contain information? And are they one of the world's most unique forms of writing, or not? The word khipu comes from the Quechuan word for knot, and they look kind of like a really intricate necklace. But they're part of a debate about what actually counts as writing, and also what makes a successful civilization. See, from ancient Rome to the Abbasid Caliphate, empires throughout history used writing to pass on information, and also for fun administrative tasks like taxes and census data. You know, all the stuff that helps you oversee a massive territory with a lot of people. Defining writing is tricky, but in most of the ways we recognize, it seems like the Inca didn't have it. And the Inca did just fine running their sprawling empire like drill sergeants overseeing a training exercise. But there's no evidence they ever had a written language, just that they had khipu. It's hard to say how old khipu really are. We do know for sure they were used during the Wari Empire, which ran from around the 6th to 11th centuries in modern-day Peru. The Wari Empire collapsed suddenly, and we still haven't figured out exactly what their khipu were used for or how to read them. But after the Wari came the Inca, and with them, drumroll, the golden age of khipu. Ink and khipu were made from cloth, usually cotton, and fibers from animals like alpacas and llamas. Khipu typically included a primary cord with pendant cords hanging off of it, as well as subsidiary cords hanging off of those. And they were structured a bit like a fabric abacus, with knots placed in specific areas. They could be relatively small or really big. The longest one ever found has over 1,800 strings and is around 5 meters in length. Khipu also had plenty of other attributes, like different colors and types of knots, and even different ways the strings were twisted together, called the ply. Historical records show that Incan messengers called chasqui delivered khipu using a relay road system. There's no indicator that chasqui could understand khipu, though. For that role, the Inca used specialists to interpret khipu and share their contents with others. These experts were called khipu kamayak, and they were trained from a young age to become savvy state record keepers. Now, it's possible the khipu kamayak were just uniquely chosen to become the only literate people in their civilization. Think of Egyptian scribes being specially trained to read and write hieroglyphs. But it's also possible they were more like musicians. Like, in theory, anyone could learn to read sheet music for a viola part and understand what the notes individually mean. But to actually convey what the music is saying, you'd have to know a lot more, like how to move from a C sharp on the G string to an E on the A string, and so on. In other words, it's possible that the khipu kamayak had specialized knowledge, with the khipu serving as something like a memory aid, rather than containing all the information within itself. We know the Inca used khipu up to and through Spanish colonization, and sometimes the Spanish encouraged their use for religious or record-keeping purposes. But typical Spanish conquerors, for the most part, they condemned khipu as idolatrous and destroyed most of the ones they got their hands on. Over time, khipu use died out. Some Andean villages kept using khipu, but otherwise they pretty much went the way of the dinosaur. And so that we don't do the same, let's take a quick break for an ad.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. Brilliant is an online learning platform where you can develop your skills and deepen your knowledge. And you can do all of that for a month for free, which is something we can get behind here at SciShow. They've got courses on math, data analysis, and more, so you won't run out of topics to explore. Whether you're just starting or you're already a pro, Brilliant has classes designed to build on your skills and give you an interactive challenge. You'll get to solve puzzles and work with real data, so you stay engaged while you learn. To try Brilliant, visit brilliant.org/scishow, scan the QR code on screen, or click on the link in the video description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
So how do we know so much about khipu? For one thing, we have the records of Spanish colonizers, but we also have a mathematician with the delightful name of Leslie Leland Locke to thank. A little over 100 years ago, our guy Leslie figured out that a lot of khipu are numerical and used a base 10 number system. Decades later, other researchers found that khipu typically consisted of cords that had powers of 10, with different types and placements of knots coming together to convey a number. Each cord on a khipu was arranged like this, with knots in a series of rows. Those knots typically made up a total number with rows divided into sections. A ones row, a tens row, a hundreds row, and on for as long as they wanted to go. In the ones row, you'd find a long knot with twists in it representing what the number should be. So if a khipu cord wanted to convey the number 432, the ones row, representing 2, would have a long knot with 2 twists. But at least in some cases, the rest of the cord would show single knots representing multiples of 10. So for 432, above the long knot with 2 twists, there would be a cluster of 3 knots together in the tens place for 30, and then above that would be a cluster of 4 knots together in the hundreds place for 400. You'd be reading these top down, which is how you'd get to 432. Now, things got a little spicier if you wanted to represent the number 1, which used a figure 8 knot. Meanwhile, no knot at all meant 0, and that would all be on one chord, sometimes with many more to follow. Not all numerical khipu are the same. Some had knots that were more like codes, standing in for things like places or individuals. Like, khipu from one archaeological site near Lima appeared to use a set of knots representing the area of Puruchuco, kind of like an ancient zip code. About 2/3 of the khipu we've ever found are numerical, but the rest are a big mystery. We tend to call those narrative khipu, and we think they contain a lot of information about battles, history, and even things like poetry and astrology. After all, khipu are really complex, potentially way more so than they'd need to be if they were just meant to jog a khipu kamaic's memory. Plus, there are a lot of Spanish records claiming that khipu held information that went far beyond numbers. They wrote about how the Chasqui runners carried khipu containing things like administrative tasks or descriptions of conflict. But how was that information recorded? Was it like written Quechua knot addition, or more like conveying pictures through string? Well, welcome to a big dispute among experts. One theory is that narrative khipu are semasiographic, which would mean they're a system of symbols that contain information. Think about road signs. We all kinda know that an image of a moose means to be on the lookout for gigantic mammals with antlers that can roll through your windshield. Some supporters of this theory argue that khipu sort of form a 7-bit binary code, using elements like fiber type and the ply and spin of a knot to create distinctions between symbols. Researchers supporting this theory say khipu could have stored more than 1,500 units of information this way, beyond what ancient writing systems like Egyptian hieroglyphs could. Another big one argues that khipu are logosyllabic, meaning they use symbols to stand in for words and concepts, but also sounds, like Chinese does. That theory rests heavily on an 18th century rebellion effort against Spain by leaders from the small village of San Juan de Coyota in the Peruvian Andes. Their communications were recorded on khipu, and kept for centuries by villagers until anthropologist Sabine Hyland arrived and was invited to view this holy grail of khipu research. Hyland had only 48 hours to examine the khipu, and it was a full sensory experience. The khipu had 14 colors and hair from 6 different types of animals, some of which could only be identified by touch. While using touch and texture to guide her inspection, Hyland and her husband cross-referenced the khipu with more than 1,000 pages of historical written testimony. She finally determined that the khipu relied on a system of 95 symbols. Some were phonetic, or represented sounds, and the rest were ideographic, meaning they represented an idea or a concept. Hyland got to that conclusion by parsing out what seems to be the signatures of former village leaders from the rebellion plot, who used a combination of color, fiber, and knots to form syllables and concepts. Signatures make sense at the end of a communication like a letter, and Hyland already knew she was looking at messages between people. That made it a lot easier for her to catch on quickly when she began to notice phonetic patterns. In one instance, a final blue pendant seemed to signal the local word for the color ancas, providing the letters K and A for the end of the name Aluka. Alas, for Koyata's scrappy resistance fighters, records show their rebellion wound up crushed. And while decoding parts of the Koyata khipu was a watershed moment in khipu research and understanding, there are still some major caveats. For one thing, they're the only phonetic khipu ever discovered. They could be a one-off regional variation that doesn't share much in common at all with other khipu from elsewhere. Plus, they date to a time when the Inca had already interacted with the Spanish and writing as a concept, which could have introduced changes in the way khipu were used. So, are khipu a kind of writing? Well, an unsatisfying answer is that we won't know until we've actually cracked the code. For now, those narrative khipu lying around are keeping their secrets to themselves. But a better question might be whether it actually matters. Instead of wondering how an empire could thrive without writing, maybe we need to reconsider what it means to administer one in the first place. Writing is an incredible tool, but it's not the only way to communicate or effectively perform administrative tasks. The Inca are a great example. They used khipu to do so much, and to do it really well. Maybe we'll find that there are many types of khipu, and some are writing and some aren't, and some are a cool hybrid of writing and math, unlike anything we've ever encountered. And maybe they used khipu for telling stories, and maybe a khipu kumayak had to get involved. And maybe we'll never know. But what we do know is they came up with a really complex and fascinating system unlike anything we've ever seen. That was enough to help them run a successful empire, whether it was writing or not.